Reliance upon creation dependency. Although it's impossible they can depend or rely upon creation. Okay, that's the negating attributes. We now move on to the existing attributes. What's the first of the existing attributes here?
Will.
Will? What's the opposite of will? No will. It is. So what does that now mean? No will.
No, it has to have someone else to do something for them. But no, I have to think for them, sorry.
Okay. You sure? I'm not too sure about that. Anybody else? See nobody there? Happy like Allah. Allah preserve. No, don't you answer. That's a Sheikh of Aqidah. Don't you answer. Let the students answer here. What's the opposite of will? And see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has complete will. What's the opposite of that? Go on, answer what he said. Go on. Coercion. Coercion. Allah subhanahu is not forced, not compelled to do anything. Because will is based on choice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not required. And that's why we say, just to add the points in here, we say Allah subhanahu is not required to do anything for creation. Not required to do anything for creation. It's not wajib upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He provides for you. It's not wajib upon Him that He puts you into Jannah, even if you fulfill everything. Why is it wajib that He will do these things? Because He said so. Not because He has to do it. He doesn't have to do it. Anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does for humanity and for creation is also His fadl and His rahmah. It's from His grace and from His mercy. And here we have a clear distinction with the Mu'tazila. Those in our audience, those from Mu'tazila. Where they say that Allah subhanahu has to do what's called a salah wal aslah. Allah subhanahu has to do what's good for humanity in creation and what's best for humanity in creation. No. We say no, Allah subhanahu chooses from His will and He's not imposed, He's not required to do anything. Why? Because if He has to do something, then He's forced into His coercion. So that's impossible. What's the opposite? Or what's the next one after that? The second of the existing attributes?
Power.
Power, yeah. But what's the opposite?
Powerless.
See, that's an opposite. That's a feeble, powerless, incapable, and so on. What's the next one? No, you've already answered. We need to move around. You also know the answer. That'll be the Barcelona top one. Somebody else. Knowledge, okay. The opposite being ignorance. Ignorance, right. And there are other opposites as well. The obvious one is ignorance. So this one is not ignorance of any matter. The next one, next word.
Life.
Opposite's obvious. And he can't be dead. Next one.
Sight.
He can't be blind. Next one.
Speech,
it can't be done. And the last one, hearing, it can't be there. Those last three, though we said, we only say that because of rational proofs. Sorry, Afwan, because of scriptural proofs, not because of rational proofs. Because we don't now start arguing, therefore, that he's got to walk because the opposite, that he'd be disabled or crippled us. We don't use those as arguments. We say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says he speaks, so that's why we say that. He says he hears, that's why we say that. He sees, that's why we say it. We don't use rational arguments there. Yeah?
Then the negation of the hearing, sight, and speech. If you only affirm them to be scriptural, so it's a negation of what we say. Shouldn't that only be the scriptural proof as well? Because you mentioned his sight is different to our sight. And our sight, we can't see, but we can find a person who's blind.
No. I mean, once we said that Allah subhanahu said that, then the opposite is impossible. Once he said that, then the direct opposite of that is impossible. That's all we're saying. He said that he sees. What's the opposite of that? That he can't see. No. Whatever that means in relation to Allah subhanahu, it doesn't mean like, because I mean, we don't even need to start trying to understand what that means, because all we're saying is just not possible. It's just not possible. So we don't need any further confirmation. He said he sees. The opposite, therefore, is impossible. Any questions? Are we okay with this? Nice and easy? No? Now we get to the easier bits. Your question.
Should that not be 12?
Why is it 12?
7 plus 5.
Plus 1. Because of those existence, the first. Now we've done now what's necessary. You've got 13 attributes necessary. Then we've done the impossibles, direct opposites. That's why we don't need to really focus too much on them. Whatever is necessary, the opposite is impossible for lost planet time. Also, another point I want to emphasize here. And this is a point that's raised by some people, and we mentioned at the beginning, just to clarify this point and stress this point. Where do we get the 13 attributes from? Where are we getting this from? Doesn't Allah span have 99 names and names indicate attributes, and doesn't he have beyond that as well? Saying Aqidah, these are the fundamental attributes. These are the fundamental attributes. And from each of these attributes, other attributes, we can take out other attributes. Imam al-Juwayni, rahimullah, the Shaykh Imam al-Ghazali, has got a work in Aqidah where he does exactly that. And Imam al-Ghazali, rahimullah, himself has a work on Aqidah, Sharh Asma'ullah al-Husna, the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In there, he touches upon this point in his introduction. He said, when we say 13 names or attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're not restricting. Say, these are the fundamental attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by which we can define divinity. From these other attributes emanate. You have al-Muntaqim, the one, the avenger. You have al-Latif, the subtle. You have al-Kareem, the generous. Say, what Imam joins this traces each one of them goes back to one of these attributes. You tie them all into these attributes. Say, these are the fundamental from which all of the other attributes emanate from. Then we go into the realm of possible. The necessary and impossible relate to the divine essence. When we look at possible, we're looking at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala interacts with this creation. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala interacts with this creation. God may choose to implement that which is possible or excluded, like creating, like providing, placing you in heaven. He doesn't need to do that. He can put you into hellfire, even if you worship him forever. That's all in the realm of possibility. Why do we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put the believer in heaven? Not because he has to, it's because he said so. Why do we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must provide for humankind? Not because he has to. It's in the realm of possibility. He said he will do that, and he won't break his word. So therefore, we say it's wajib, shara'an, not aqlan. It's legally wajib for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because he said it. Not that it's necessary upon him to do. He could create you and then throw you straight into hellfire. Like you've got people asking the question, why did God create humanity and then he's going to put them into hellfire? So it's his kingdom, he can do whatever he wants. He created a kingdom. I mean, that's not an answer that's going to make a lot of people happy. But if you just thought about rational, you've proven that he created you. It's his kingdom. You're his creation. You've accepted all of that. He can do whatever he wants with you. He can throw you into hellfire. And this, with complete adab to the prophets, and this is mentioned in books of Aqidah, and we only mention because this is a classroom setting. So the prophets, we have utmost respect because they are the elite of humankind. We're going to speak about that later on. But the ulama of Aqidah said, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he can throw all of the prophets into hellfire for eternity. He's not obliged to do anything. Now, adab and ma'alam biya, we wouldn't say that. Alphabetically with the prophets, and public in a public forum, he's going to say that. But to understand here the nature of the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can do absolutely whatever he wants. Even the Prophet ﷺ said that. He said, I would not enter into Jannah if it was not for the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's not that he has to put me into Jannah. He still likes to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like no human being could ever worship. He still did not have right to enter into Jannah. It's still through the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he goes into Jannah. That's what he still likes from himself said. Wala anta ya Rasulullah. He said, none of you will enter into heaven through your deeds. What should that remove from your heart? A sickness, in which we talk about in spirituality, it's called al-i'timadu ala al-amal, relying upon your deeds. Don't think for a moment, because you are a devout believer, you've got any right to heaven. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to judge you based on his justice, he'd throw you straight into hellfire. You've done nothing for him. And you can never do anything for him. And the grace of humankind couldn't do anything for him. Say, well, anta ya Rasulullah, not even your messenger, he said, not even me. Had it not been Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he subhanahu wa ta'ala would not cover me with his mercy, then not even I would enter into Jannah. So even the Prophet and all the prophets, all of humanity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could place Iblis in the highest level of Jannah. And he could place the greatest wali in the lowest level of hellfire. It's all in the realm of possibility, but he doesn't do it because he said that he won't do it that way. he doesn't do because he's told us exactly how he's going to do it.
Can he break his promise?
No. No. He said, why? Because he said, he would say shara'an as well as aqlan, rationally as well as legally. Legally, in the Quran says, Inna Allah la yukhlifu al-mi'ad. He said that in many places, Allah does not break his promise. So he's told you that he's not going to. Rationally, is that possible? So that's a sign of deficiency within. Mm-hmm. That's a sign of deficiency. Like, there's all this debate, can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lie? So rationally, it's not possible. Rationally, it's not possible. As well as shara'an, it's not possible. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot lie. So that's it. Now you've restricted the power of God. So you know that's a deficiency we now within divinity. Aqlan, rationally, that's a divinity. That's a deficiency within divinity. Can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala break his promise? No. No, he can't break his promise.